Hello, welcome to The Real Internet. Come forth, meet the author session live. My name is Antoinette Smith, and I'm your author. Remember to get your books, people. Some of them are on sale at Barnes & Noble, Amazon, Google, Apple iTunes, Walmart.com, Target.com, Books A Million, Kobo, Indigo, and Tails. All of them come in paperback and digital version. Get your copies today. Remember, we are reading from the Real Internet Comfort Book Series, Volume 1, 2, and 3. We are currently in Volume Number 1. Remember to send all your questions and comments and concerns, and I will address them live. Okay? We are reading from Chapter 3. It is titled Rebellion, and this is Age 7. I am 7 years old now and very rebellious and defiant. In today's terms, I will be considered a juvenile delinquent. I am a straight-up tomboy. I climb trees. I play football, basketball, and baseball. I jump off of our roof and the neighbor's roof, too. I still wet the bed, and I think about what happened to me. My mom and stepdad have gotten a divorce. We are continuing to rotate from his house to my dad's house on the weekends and school breaks. My father takes me to Chicago a lot to stay and visit my older brothers and sisters. Now allow me to give you a little history. On my father's side, excuse me, I am the baby of 32, according to my father's own words, he said to me and the insurance man. My response was, "Are you sure I'm the baby?" He said, "Yes, I made you at age 52. I said, "Wow." So when I was born, most of my siblings were grown with children. I was born an auntie. I have nieces and nephews older than I am, and some of them are the same age as I am. My brothers and sisters used to keep me, and I played with their children. I have never met all of my siblings, but my father made it possible for me to know the ones that were close by, which were about 17 or 18. I love to go stay with my... Wait a minute. I stayed the most with one of my sisters and her family. We looked like triplets. She, her daughter, and I, especially my niece and I, we look and sound alike. I was visiting Kankakee, my hometown, from Mississippi. After I moved, this one guy approached me at the store, was like, "You can't speak?" I said, "Hello." He was like, "Don't act like you don't know me." I responded, "I don't." He said, "Your name is," and said, "My niece's name." I laughed and said, "No, that's my niece." He said, "You look and sound just like her. That's why I spoke." I said, "She's taller and thinner than me. But yeah, that's my niece." When people see me in Illinois or Mississippi, they know my father. They say, "You got to be Jim's daughter." I laugh and say, "Yes." Or they'll ask, "You are Pendleton." My brothers spoil me rotten. They are just like my father toward me. "Don't mess with me, or better not hit me, or it'll be World War II. We'll start all over again." I promise you, when I was with my brothers, they and their girlfriends took me shopping, got my hair done. I remember one time my daddy told my sister to take me to get my hair done, and she did. Take me to get my hair done, and she did my hair. She did my hair. I cried like it was no tomorrow. I said, my daddy told you to take me to the shop. And while I was crying, one of my brothers, who was also my heart shoe, came in and rescued me. He said, "Baby, get your hair combed. I'm taking you shopping after she's done." I stopped crying and I got glad. But I stayed with him a lot too. I used to go watch my siblings play baseball, and they were all one team. I used to watch them dance and sing all the time. I know I was loved by the majority of my siblings, especially my brothers, all of them. But to be truthful, only two of my sisters loved me as a child. One is dead now. I really got to know her when I was 9. She moved to Kankakee with my daddy. Yes, I call him my daddy. I always have, always will. She took up a lot of time with me until the day she died. I was grown with 4 children. I was blessed beyond measure to have a close relationship with her. She made the rejection I felt from the other siblings of none a void. The rest of them liked me because my daddy wouldn't have it any other way. But one of them didn't love or like me and made it clear each time I saw her. That was very hard for me because I loved her and looked up to her because all of my other siblings were like, she is to be respected at all times. And by me being with my brothers more, I saw how they would change their behavior when we got to her house. Plus, I got a pep talk. Don't do this. Don't do that when you get here, okay? And I would say, okay. So as I got older, I just didn't say or do certain things around her. But I always called her, showed up at her house, whether it was good or bad news, and loved her. A couple of my sisters, I don't remember spending the night with them, but I visit them with my dad and our other siblings. Nevertheless, as I got older, I met more of my siblings and I loved them all. I loved my brothers more because I was with them more, and I still am that way today. I am their baby, even at 39 years old. Glory be to God. I am now have a relationship with all of my sisters, and we are planning sister time, which is a miracle to me. But God is faithful and just, and will turn anyone's heart toward him and his people if he chooses to. I am grateful I found favor with God and man. Well, all of us would go to my stepfather's house, but on the other weekends, my oldest brother, who is 2.5 years older than me, I would go to my real father's house. My two other brothers never came with us because they were tired of being with us children. They were beginning to be teenagers. Yeah, we got new bikes. Yay, we got new bikes. My father just bought my youngest brother, Andre, and me a brand new bike called Milk Trucks. 24-inch bikes. Now, Andre and I were partners in crime. We would get into the most trouble together. I got the most whoopings because I would never confess my faults, nor would I admit that my wrongdoings all a part of my rebellion. Now, we were allowed to ride our bikes all day, but not at night. We would wait until my mom was in bed and sneak out the house at night to ride our bikes. We got caught by the police a few times and being out past our curfew. He always warned us and he would tell my mom we lived in a town called Hopkins Park, Illinois, where everybody knew everybody, where my parents knew everybody. We lived right down the street from the police station, so all of the officers knew us children and which family we belonged to. So for a week or two straight, my brother and I were sneaking out the house riding our bikes. We got caught again. So the officer said, the next time I catch you two, I'm taking your bikes and telling your mother. We would ride in the street, and when we saw car lights, we would ride in the ditch and lie down. And I know that we were terrible children, but I didn't care. The officer called us and took us home. Lord, we are about to be beat. I mean beat. My mother didn't play. The officer said, Miss Scott, I have called Tookie, my nickname, and Andre out past curfew for the second time this week and riding their bikes and warned them. And I told them I would take their bikes and tell you. And I caught them. So I've hold their bikes for 1 week. And then you can pick them up. I screamed, no, don't take my bike. I promise I won't ride at night. He said, no, because you told me that last week. My mother was hot. She said, y'all ain't had no business out this house outside. Y'all had no business outside this house at night anyway. And for 2 weeks, thank you, officer. I'll take care of them. Don't worry. And if their father don't pick up their bikes, they won't get them back. And, oh, we were about to get it. As soon as my mother closed the door, she got the extension cord. Yes, that's right, an extension cord with the plug into a wall for the electricity. She said, I know it was your idea, Tookie, and you went out this house while I was asleep. You could have gotten hit by a car or hurt, and I wouldn't have known nothing. But when I get off of your blank, I bet you won't dock that door anymore. Now, while my mother was saying all of this, she was already whooping me. Then she laid it on my brother, telling him, you're going to learn not to listen to Tookie after I get off of you, after I get off of your blank blank this time too. So our bikes were at the police station. And of course, my mom told both our dads what had happened. But as always, they talk to us, telling us we were doing wrong and to behave ourselves. Our father never had to whip us because my mother took care of that for sure. They actually felt sorry for us by the way my mother disciplined us and everything she laid her hand with everything she laid her hands on. But instead of us taking heed to punishment, we got into more trouble. We got caught jumping off the roof of our house. The neighbors told on us. We got beaten for that as well. We went on to the town rodeo through the woods down the street from our home. Of course, we got caught. The police brought us home and another beating took place. As if it would stop us, we waited until my mom left home and we hid in the woods and threw rocks at cars as they passed by from the rodeo. Oh my, we broke windows and ran deep into the woods to hide. Of course, the police tried to blame us. They came to our home and lo and behold, my real father was present at the time. He said to the officer, "Can you prove my children broke these windows and threw these rocks at these cars?" The officer said, "No, but I have had trouble with your children all month long." My father told him, "Yes, and I've been meaning to talk to you about that. You're going to give my children back their bikes right now. I bought them bikes, not you. And stop blaming my children for everything that goes wrong in this community. Every time something happened here, they come accusing our children. This is your last and final warning." We got our bikes back right then and there. See, you have to know my father wasn't just a man. He was a man of power and of great influence around the world, not just in Illinois. So when he spoke, things happened and people listened attentively. My father was a man of great honor who helped families, people. Both my parents thought they could save the world. My father paid people's bills and bought children's clothes and took them on field trips, made them feel important with their families. My mother cooked for all the whole community. Everyone ate and stayed at our house. My mother housed multiple families, children, and people. There was always someone staying at our house a night or two or for months. Me being me, Antoinette, I wanted them all to disappear, to find their own homes and their own families, and to let our own father and let their own father buy them food and clothes and take them on field trips. I wanted my parents for myself. So I called my father my daddy because in my eyes, he only is my daddy. I thought to myself when I grew up, I'm only having one child and a girl, getting married, be a nurse to help sick people and serve the Lord as a missionary. And no one will live in my family's house at all. And I'm definitely not cooking even one bean in my house. I'm sick of it all. And I'm going to end the chapter right there. Remember to get your books, people. We are reading from The Real Antoinette Come Forth, Value Number 1, titled The Darkness Began. And we're talking about molestation. When I was started to be molested, my behavior changed. So that's what we're talking about and reading about. So if you know anyone that can benefit from these books, these videos, share it with them. Send all your questions, your comments, and concerns, and I will address them live. Remember, until we meet again, God gets the glory and I tell the story. Goodbye.